And this impetus to free slaves, this drive to emancipate, is so widespread and consistent that if you look in Islamic history, now Islamic history is very long and very broad geographically, but in general, this is a generalization, but I think it's a fairly accurate one. People who were slaves to Muslims were not slaves for their whole lives. They were usually slaves for like 7 to 10 years, and then they were freed. And if they became Muslim in that time, they entered the Muslim community as members in good standing, as citizens like anybody else. And by the way, this is another argument for why there was not an indigenous movement for abolition in the Islamic world like there was in the Americas, especially the Caribbean, in the 1700s and 1800s. Why? If you were, first of all, the majority of slaves brought into Islamic civilization were women, who then were made part of families and who had children with those families. So they were integrated into those communities. The second reason is if you were a freed slave in the Caribbean or in the United States, you're still a black person. You could still be re-enslaved, like in the movie 12 Years a Slave. You're still treated like garbage. And worse, you weren't an enfranchised member of society. So the only way, as long as slavery existed, you were under threat of re-enslavement. The only way to get rid of, to ever feel safe, was to end slavery or to do what's called maroonage, which means you basically go and you live in some isolated part of an island with other freed, with other escaped or freed slaves. For Muslims who were freed slaves, they were part of the society. They could be successful merchants. They could be Muslim scholars. They could be saints. In my book, there's a whole section on slave saints, by the way. Saints who are slaves. Awliya. The way that we can talk about abolition in Islamic tradition that I think is the most accurate is to say that, and this is entirely authentic in the Sharia tradition, that as a legal maxim says, يَتَشَوَّفُ الشَّارِعُ إِلَى الْحُرِيَّةِ, the lawgiver, God, looks expectantly towards freedom. And actually, you can find this in one of the earliest books that survives in Islamic tradition, the Kitab al-Tahrish of Dirar ibn Amr. There's a hadith, we talked about this hadith actually. It comes from the very early period. We don't know if the Prophet said it or not, but it's a very early idea. If a man says to his wife, أنتِ طالق إن شاء الله, she's not divorced, because God doesn't want divorce. But if you say to your slave, أنتَ حُر إن شاء الله, the slave is freed. Why? Because God wants freedom. So one of the, even if you look in the Kitab al-Muwafaqat of Ash-Shatibi, died 1388, a major scholar of the Maqasid of the Sharia, he says one of the Maqasid of the Sharia is al-itq, freeing slaves. And if we now live in a time when it's economically, not just economically feasible, but economically profitable not to have slaves, if we can remove the harm of slavery, and this is something I forgot to mention, which I'll shoehorn in really quickly. Muslim scholars always recognized that slavery was harmful. They talked about darar ar-riq, the harm of slaves. What was the harm of slavery? They realized that being a slave was not pleasant for a lot of people. It was you were unable to make your free choices. You were, you couldn't, let's say, lead prayer or lead a Jummah prayer. Right? You were unable to benefit from the fruits of your own labor if you wanted. So that's why they understood that freeing people was a good thing. That's why there's fadl in itq. You get a reward for freeing people. But they also understood that it wasn't the most, they believed it was not the most important thing. So if someone was too old or too sick or too incompetent to handle themselves, it was actually wrong to free them, because they were going to be worse off if they were freed. So if we are in a position in world history where slavery is not needed economically, if we're in a position where we can remove the harm of itq from people, then the best way to fulfill this maqsid, this aim of the Sharia, of emancipation, is simply to do a categorical emancipation and get rid of the institution as a whole. Jazakum Allahu khair, and I can't believe I actually finished this, and I'll try and answer your questions afterwards, inshallah.